The Israelites set out on a long desert journey back to their homeland. God guided them with a pillar of fire at night and a cloud by day. As the Israelites set up camp at the base of Mount Sinai, a dark cloud covered the mountaintop. Thunder boomed and lightning filled the sky. Terrified, the people backed away from the mountain. But Moses climbed up into the dark cloud. The ground began to shake, and God spoke to Moses from a blazing fire on the mountaintop. Here is how my people should live. Don't worship anything but me. Don't misuse or disrespect my name. Set aside a day each week to rest and worship me. Honor your parents. Don't murder, steal, or lie. Live purely and faithfully. Don't lust after someone else's spouse or their possessions. When Moses told the people these commands, they said, "We'll do everything God said." On the mountaintop, God gave him stone tablets detailing the laws and commands inscribed by God's own finger. When Moses returned to their camp, he found the Israelites in a wild party, worshiping a golden idol they made. The people said, "We want to follow a God that we can see." Burning with anger, Moses threw the tablets, breaking them into pieces. Then he ground their idol into powder, mixed it with water, and made them drink it. Moses begged God to forgive his people. God said to him, "I'm full of compassion and love and slow to get angry. If my people obey my commands, then I'll show my power through them." After giving Moses a new set of tablets, God said, "Build a special place for me to live among the people I love." So Moses gathered the very best craftsmen and built a sacred tent called a tabernacle in the center of their camp. When God was present inside the tent, a cloud appeared above it during the day and a pillar of fire at night. When the cloud moved, the people followed and continued their long journey back to their homeland.
Well, welcome back to Chapter 5 of the story, and if you're just joining us, this is a unique Bible that we're working through. It's an abridged version of the Bible. It's not the entire Bible, but it takes the major stories of the Bible and lays them out on a timeline called the story, so we can kind of get a sense of this sweeping scope of the story of Scripture. And I'm glad you're here for that. And let me show of hands, how many of you did your homework and read chapter 5 this week? Just, okay, good, good. How many of you were cramming in the parking lot to finish up before you came in? Hey, I've been hearing reports about that. And so really glad. Now this week, we get to the Ten Commandments. Who's excited to get to the Ten Commandments, you know? Oh yeah, I gotta get me some commandments, right? And you know, you kinda wish there were 15 commandments, don't you? Not so much? Well, actually, there really were. I remember.
"Lord, I shall give these laws unto thy people. Hear me. Oh, hear me. All pay heed. The Lord Jehovah, has given unto you these 15. Ten commandments for all to obey."
If I live to be 100, that'll always be funny right there. Well, I hope for many of you who've been with us that you're starting to understand how some things fit together in the Bible that you hadn't figured out before, that you hadn't put together. For instance, many of you have probably watched the old movie, The Ten Commandments, you know, on Easter Sunday or something, some Sunday night in the past, and you always wondered, how did the Israelites end up in Egypt in the first place? And now you know. Joseph was sent there through a time of difficulty on a hard path. God put him ahead there so he could prepare for a time of famine. And then his descendants came, and he was able to feed them. And the descendants, the Israelites, his dad's name was Israel, or Jacob, known as both. Those 12 tribes of Israel, they multiplied and they multiplied into 2 or 3 million people. And they're enslaved by Pharaoh. And so God calls Moses to be the deliverer and to say, go let my people go. And we talked about Moses last week. And by the way, there was one part of Moses' story I forgot to tell you about when he was a kid. And we don't know for sure this really happened, but maybe it did. I thought that was really funny. Baby Moses parting the bath waters, you know? Maybe not so much. Maybe not so much. Well, God calls Moses to go to Pharaoh and to say, let my people go. And of course, Pharaoh says no. And 10 plagues later, after God sends the plague of the death angel who passed over Egypt, taking the firstborn son of every household, except the ones who had taken the blood of an innocent lamb and put it over the door frame of their house, the death angel passed over those houses. And finally, Pharaoh said, go, go. And the Egyptians were so glad to get rid of the Israelites after this plague, they gave them all their gold and their jewelry, and they took off. And then they hit another obstacle. They came to the Red Sea. And now the Egyptian army is in pursuit because Pharaoh's changed his mind, and there's no way over it, under it, around it. And God does another miracle. And he parts the Red Sea, and they walk through as if on dry land. And then after they're through, the waters come down and they drown the Egyptian armies. And then God provides for them what they need in the desert. Manna to eat, quail to eat, water from a rock, a cloud to guide them by day, a pillar of fire to guide them by night. And 3 months go by. And they're now at Mount Sinai. And you would kind of think, well, this would be a good point to end the story. Hooray, they're free, they've been delivered, God wins, all those kinds of things. But God says, oh no, I'm going to share with you a new bit of information that is very important for you to understand. God says, now I am going to choose to live with you. Now this is unheard of for them. If you were with us from the beginning of the story, you remember that when Adam and Eve sinned, it broke the relationship with God. It broke the fellowship, the community that they had with God. God's Spirit left them. And remember, we said the story of the Bible is how God has worked in history to restore the relationship with broken people like us. And ever since Adam and Eve, God has not been living with people. He's not been dwelling with people. Because sin separated them from God. God has been interacting with people. He interacted with Noah. He interacted with Abraham. He interacted with Moses. But God has not been dwelling with people. And this brings us to the big idea that we're going to discover here in chapter 5 of the story. And that is, more than interacting with you, more than being near you, God desires to live in you. He doesn't want to just interact with you. He doesn't want to just be near you. God wants to live in you. And the first step God was going to take in this direction to live in people was going to say, I'm going to come near you and dwell among you. And God says, I'm going to come down there, but for me to do this, there's a couple of things that need to take place first. And here's your outline today. Number one, my people need a blueprint to follow. And number two, my spirit is going to need a place to dwell. My people will need a blueprint to follow, and my spirit will need a place to dwell. So God invites Moses to come up to Mount Sinai to verbalize the Ten Commandments. Now, God is great, and God is awesome, and God is powerful. And when we get to page 61 of the story, we read down in the second paragraph that when the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and they said to Moses, speak to us yourself and we will listen, Moses, but do not have God speak to us or we will die. God tries to have a town hall meeting with the Israelites and they beg Moses, he is so awesome. God is so great. You go talk to him, Moses, because if we do, we'll die. So Moses and his brother Aaron go up the mountain in the lightning, in the smoke, in the fire. the thunder, and God verbalizes the Ten Commandments and a few other guidelines of importance. And then Moses comes down the mountain and he shares those Ten Commandments that God has given to both he and Aaron. The commandments: number one, you shall have no other gods before me. Number two, you shall not make any idols to worship. Number three, you shall not misuse my name. Number four, you shall remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Now, these first four commandments all have a theme to them. The first four are all about how we relate to God, our vertical relationship with him. The next six commandments are all about how we relate to one another. Commandment number five, honor your father and mother. Commandment number six, you shall not murder. Commandment number seven, you shall not commit adultery. Commandment number eight, you shall not steal. Number nine, you shall not lie. Number 10, you shall not covet. And the people had to be thinking when Moses shared these commandments, cool, no problem, these kind of make sense. This will make life better if we do this. And so the huge throng of Israelites turned to page 62. About two-thirds of the way down in the middle of a paragraph, that the huge throng of Israelites say with one voice, everything the Lord has said, we will do. Moses gives the commandments. They respond in one voice, everything the Lord has said, we will do. Now, I thought maybe we could do it like the Israelites did it today. And maybe with just one like big voice right now, we could do it with them. Can you try that with me? Let's say it together. Everything the Lord has said, we will do. We are in God. We are with you on this. So God has kept his covenant. Some of you remember he made a covenant with Abraham back in Genesis chapter 12 and said, Abraham, I'm going to raise up a great nation through you. And now God has done that. He's kept his promise, his covenant. They're a great nation. They're 2 or 3 million strong. And now God is saying, I want you to make a covenant with me. You see, God is going to move in. And he's saying to his people, we're going to have some house rules. If I'm going to come dwell among you, if we're going to live together, we're going to have a covenant and agreement. We're going to have to have a blueprint to follow. Now that's strange because Israel thinks of this as God moving into their house. Some of you know that when I was 20 years old, I did an internship, a ministry internship at Eastside. And it was for an extended period of time, and I lived during my internship for half the time with Ben and Pat Merrill, who were the senior pastor of the church at that time, and another longtime Eastside family named Howard and Margaret Dix. Now, when you're the guest in someone else's house, you want to follow the house rules, right? You know, you make your bed, you keep your room clean, you know, you want to help out with things around the house. Can you imagine if I'd come into either of those houses and I'd said, okay, we need to get some rules straight. Number one, don't touch my stuff. Number two, you are never to enter my room. Number three, if you need to communicate with me, you write it on white paper with blue ink and you slip it under the door and you disappear. I don't want to see you. That would have been a pretty short internship, don't you think? Because they would have just said, hey, you got to follow our rules. It's our house. You don't tell us how to live in our house. Understand, God is saying, Israel, I'm moving in with you, and here are my rules. Oh, wait a minute, God, you're moving in with us, and you're setting the rules, and God says, oh, didn't I tell you that earth that you live on, it's mine? That mountain that you're next to, I made it. Those bodies that you have, I gave them to you. I'm not moving into your house. You're already living in my house. And as many parents have had to say to their teenagers and young adult children who still live at home, as long as you're living in my house, you will follow and obey those rules. Absolutely right. So God says, okay, Moses, come back up to the mountain and hang out with me. Now I'm going to write these commandments down for you on stone. But Moses knows that the children of Israel need a babysitter. And so he leaves his brother Aaron behind and he goes up the mountain. Now meanwhile, back at the ranch, guess what's taking place? You won't believe this. The people get impatient waiting for Moses to return. He's up on the mountain. 1 week turns into 2 weeks. 2 weeks turns into 3 weeks. And they begin to have all sorts of questions. Where is Moses? Is he alive? When is Moses coming back? Is he ever coming back? And it's 40 days before Moses comes back down the mountain, and they start to doubt God's plan. And when you turn over to page 64, in that third paragraph toward the top of the page, it says, "When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron," that's Moses' brother, "and said, 'Come make us gods who will go before us.'" Make us gods. "As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." In other words, "Aaron, give us some type of image that we can worship as God." Isn't that amazing? These people have just said, "Everything the Lord has said, we will do." And already they're breaking the very first two commandments, "No other gods before me," wanting an idol to worship. God hadn't even had a chance to inscribe these first two commandments. And the people are going to Aaron. "That Moses guy is dead and gone. Now we want a God. We want a God. We want a God." And Aaron, the guy who had been with Moses in the first place, when he had heard God said, "Read my lips, no other gods," says, "Okay." And the story tells us how they gave him all the gold and jewelry that the Egyptians had given them when they left Egypt, and they fashioned this golden calf, and he said, "This is your God. This is the God who brought you out of Egypt. Now you worship this God." And the Bible talks about how they break out in a party, and they drink, and they dance, and they party like it's 1990 or 1446 BC. I mean, this is like Woodstock on steroids. It really is. And this is why we call them the children of Israel. They're acting like four-year-olds. And God says to Moses, who's up on the mountain, "Houston, we have a problem. Sinai, we have an issue. I need you to go down there because the very people that I just delivered have already forgotten me." You say, how does something like that happen? Well, remember, they had been in Egypt for many years, and Egyptians had many gods. They were polytheistic. They had the sun god Ra. They had the god of the Nile River. They had the Kermit the Frog god. I mean, they had all kinds of gods, you know, and now they've got their chance to make their own god. I mean, unbelievable, isn't it? They had just said, "Everything the Lord has said, we will do." And it's right after they had received the first commandments about having no other gods, no other graven images or idols. And now Moses starts down the mountain. And he gets halfway down, and he sees what's going on, and he hears the drums, and he sees the party, and it's wild. I mean, it's a wild party. And he sees this golden calf, and in a fit of rage, he becomes the only person in history to break all 10 commandments in 1 second. Just throws them down. And when he confronts Aaron about what had happened, I mean, this is unbelievable. This is the most lame excuse ever given in the history of the world. Last few words of page 65, top of page 66. Aaron says, "So I told them, 'Whoever has any gold jewelry, take it off.' Then they gave me the gold, and I threw it into the fire, and out came this calf." I mean, it sounds like a six-year-old, you know, has just manufactured this excuse for their parents, right? I didn't do it. It just happened. It just came out. Now, we laugh at that. But the truth is, our own idols in our lives are wrapped up in rationalizations and excuses. And as soon as I brought up our own idols, probably something came to your mind, and then just as quickly as it came to your mind, you put it out of your mind because you say, "Well, I don't have any idols. I'm not an idol worshiper." Listen, you always ought to listen to the first part of your mind. For some of us, it might be materialism. It's become our idol. It takes the place of God. It's why God told you to give, to beat that idol. For some, it might be pleasure. For you, your idol is just fun. Maybe it's sinful fun, maybe it's not, but it takes the place of God. For some of you, your idol might be a relationship. It might be a person, real or imagined, who occupies an obsessive amount of your time and your preoccupation and your thoughts. My wife can become an idol if she becomes more important to me than God. You may be single, and the quest for a lover is your idol. We mistakenly think that a relationship with a person can take the place of God in our life. Or for some people, for you, it might be your body. That's your idol, your body. You worship at the Cathedral of LA Fitness or the Temple of 24-Hour Fitness or something like that. Now, friends, I've just mentioned four things, just none of which are wrong in and of themselves unless they take the place of God in your life. Anything can become an idol if it takes the place of God. Psalms 106, verse 21 says, they worshiped the golden calf because they forgot God. They forgot God. Amazing, isn't it? Friends, this is why all throughout the Bible, Nehemiah, Isaiah, Corinthians, all Psalms tell us to remember, to remember, to remember. This is why the Apostle Paul told us in 1 Corinthians 10:14, therefore, my dear friends, flee from idolatry. Run, Forrest, run. Run from it. So what does Moses do? He melts down the golden calf. And then he poured it into the water supply, and he made every person drink this metallic water. Maybe they looked like this when they were done. I don't know. This was the ancient equivalent of having your mouth washed out with soap by your mom. Do you know why I think he made them drink it? I think he was trying to say to them, you think this satisfies? You think this calf fills the deepest need, the hunger in your soul? All right, just eat it and drink it down and see if it satisfies the deepest need of your soul in the way that God does. So now Moses goes back up the mountain and he has to get a replacement set of commandments. And God gives him the exact same list of 10 that he had given him before. Now, before we're all too hard on Aaron and before we're too hard on the Israelites, before we leave the Ten Commandments, I want to quickly go through them with you for a moment. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to keep track of the number of the Ten Commandments that you've never broken. And then at the end, we're going to do a little survey to see how good you really are deep down, okay? So you just keep track, maybe keep track with your fingers or make a little tally or something like that in your head. Okay, the first commandment says, you shall have no other gods before me. If you've always put God first in everything in your life, you count that as one you've never broken. The second commandment says, you shall not make any graven images or idols. And as I've said, we can have a lot of things that become idols in our life. Our cars, our kids, money, our body can become an idol. But we're not going to count it that way, okay? If you've never made a graven image and bowed down to it, you count that as one you've never broken. Aren't you glad that one's in there? The third commandment says, you shall not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. If you've never used the name of God or the name of Jesus as a swear word, if you've never used the popular phrase, oh my God, if you've never sung a worship song and carelessly just repeated the words without thinking of what you were saying, you count that as one you've never broken. The fourth commandment says, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. If you've always appropriately set aside a day for worship and spiritual refreshment in your life, if you've never skipped church in your life, you count that as one you've never broken. The fifth one says, honor your father and your mother. If as a child you never disobeyed your parents, if as an adult you've always properly shown respect toward them, you count that as one you've never broken. The sixth commandment says, thou shalt not kill. If you've never murdered anybody, you count that as one you haven't broken. Now, I know in the New Testament, Jesus said, if you have hatred in your heart towards someone, you're guilty of committing murder. But we won't count it that way, okay? If you've never physically done the act of murder, you count that as one you've never broken. The seventh commandment says, thou shalt not commit adultery. If before you were married, you were never sexually involved, if after you were married, you've always maintained sexual exclusivity, you count that as one you've never broken. Again, in the New Testament, I know Jesus said, if you have lust in your heart, you're guilty of committing adultery, but we won't count it that way, okay? If you've never committed the act. The eighth commandment says, thou shalt not steal. If you've never stolen anything, not a dime out of your mother's purse, not a towel from a hotel, not an answer off someone else's test at school, not a computer program from work, you count that as one you've never broken, okay? The ninth commandment says, thou shalt not lie. If you've never told a lie to get out of a sticky situation, if you've never exaggerated a story, if you've never told someone, gee, your hair looks terrific, when you really think, did they stick their finger in a light socket or what, you count that as one you've never broken. The 10th commandment says, thou shalt not covet. If you've never been jealous or envious of something that someone else has, a possession, a car, a piece of jewelry, a spouse, you count that as one you've never broken. Okay. You ready for the test? Let's see how good we are. How many of you say, I've kept all 10 throughout my life? Just put your hand up real high because we want to worship you. How many would say, I've kept 9? 8? 7? 6? This is a wicked church. I'm not going to go any further. I don't want to embarrass anybody. I figure in the way that we went through them, I've kept 3. I've never made a graven image. And the other 2 are none of your business. I'm not going to tell you what those are. Now, I want you to look at what the Apostle Paul said in the New Testament of the Bible in Romans 3:20. He said, therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. No one will be declared righteous by keeping the 10 commandments. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin. God didn't give us the 10 commandments to make us better. God gave us the 10 commandments to make us aware of our need for Him, to make us aware of our need for amazing grace, to make us aware of our need for Jesus Christ. You see, the law is like a mirror that we look into so we can see what we really look like. How many of you, show of hands on something, how many of you, when you got up this morning before you left the house, you looked in a mirror? Let's see your hands. Yeah, most of you. Some of you should have. And, I mean, when you first get up in the morning, you look at the in the mirror, and it's a gruesome sight, isn't it? You know, you got whiskers, you got bedhead, you got no makeup on, all those kinds of things. Now, nobody takes their mirror and uses it to comb their hair. They don't use the mirror to apply their makeup or to shave their whiskers off. The mirror helps us see who we really are. The law doesn't make us better. The law is a mirror that we look into to help us see who we really are. You say, why is this such an important lesson to learn? Look at the top of page 69. Do not worship any other god, for the Lord, notice this, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. Here's another name for God. We learned Jehovah, the I am, the great I am that I am last week. Now it says his name is jealous. Why is that? Because he wants your affection. He wants your heart. He wants your attention. We are to have no other gods. Your salary cannot be more important than he is. The house that you live in cannot be more important than he is. Your family cannot be more important than he is. Your education cannot be more important than he is. Your viewing of a certain sport in a certain month of the year. They need our prayers, don't they? Cannot be more important than he is. What I'm saying is, the story series has got to supersede the world series in your life. He's got to be more important. More than interacting with you, more than being near you, God wants to live in you. And so he gives the Israelites the house rules, the blueprint for his people to follow. And then quickly, let me add this one more thing. God wants them to create a place for his spirit to dwell. God says to Moses, if I'm going to come down, I'm going to need a place to stay. Turn back to the left a few pages to page 63. About 2/3 of the way down the page, God says, then have them make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them. Make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern I will show you. God has given them some holy rules, and now he says, I need a holy room. And this was basically an amazing, beautiful tent. It was called a tabernacle. It was like a traveling mobile home for God to dwell in. It was like an RV for God to dwell in as they're wandering through the desert toward the promised land. And inside this tabernacle, where God would dwell, was the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was a wooden box. It was 4 feet long, 2.5 feet wide. It was covered with gold. And you say, what was inside the Ark of the Covenant? If you watch the Indiana Jones movies, you know. It was the Ten Commandments fit inside of there, along with a few other things. And do you know where God told them to set up the tent? Where they were to put the tabernacle? Where they were to put it? If it was up to the Israelites, they probably said, oh, put it up on the mountain. Because he's God, and we're not, and we're afraid of him. He's so awesome. God said, no. I want the tent right smack dab in the middle of the camp. As you're traveling, wandering through the wilderness, every time we set up a new camp, I want you to start by putting up the tabernacle first. That's where I'll dwell. And then I want you to put all the tents of everybody else around it. I don't want to be on the periphery of your life. I don't want to be out in the garage. I don't want to be out in the casita. I don't want to be out in the mother-in-law's quarters. I want to be right in the family room with you. I want to dwell with you. And you might be sitting here thinking, well, what does this have to do with us today? I'm glad you asked that, because God has a grand plan for your life. And in the big scheme of things, on every page of this book is God's passionate desire to be united in a relationship with you. He doesn't want to just be near you. He doesn't want to just dwell among you. He wants to live in you. And you see, in the New Testament era, through Jesus Christ, we get something the Israelites never had. We don't just get God with us. We don't just get God dwelling among us. We get God living in us through God the Holy Spirit. More than interacting with you, more than being near you, God wants to live in you. This is why Jesus came, Emmanuel, God with us. It's the Christmas story. He lived a perfect life. He died in a sacrifice as the perfect Lamb of God for our sin. And those who accept him, those who put the blood of Jesus on the door frame of their heart, the death angel passes over, judgment passes over. And today, God lives not in a tabernacle, not in a traveling tent, not in a temple made by human hands, not in a church building. God lives in you who follow and know Jesus Christ. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. But God, being the perfect gentleman, doesn't barge his way in. He waits to be invited. He waits for you to invite him in. And you know what I'm wondering today? I'm wondering who is on the Lord's side. I'm wondering who will say, everything the Lord has spoken, we will do. Psalm says of the Israelites, it says, you traded the Lord your God for a bull that eats grass. It's in the Bible. You traded the Lord your God for a bull that eats grass. How dumb a trade is that? That's like the most ludicrous trade in all of history. No one has ever made a trade as bad as Aaron made that day. We're going to trade God for a cow, for a cold metal cow. Why would you choose a cow over your glorious God? Why would you choose a relationship over God? Why would you choose money over God? Why would you choose a vehicle over God? Why would you allow your paycheck or your friendships or your family members to become more important than the perfect God of the universe who loves you unconditionally and gave his one and only son for you? That's a ludicrous trade. And yet the Israelites, who praise God one day and live like the devil the next day, like them, we make foolish trades regularly, don't we? And so I wonder today, who is ready to say, everything the Lord has spoken, we will do.
The desert sand whirls with the wind, carried by cries of distant Egyptian echoes. The Red Sea long closed. A voice, rich and flowing like heaven's fountain, calls from the smoke-covered mountain. You have seen what I have done, how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Israel's eyes have cried a wealth of tears through countless lost years, but now she is free. Free from Pharaoh's orders, free from Egypt's borders, free from the slave work of brick and mortar. For these slaves have seen their creator command his creation, and now this God has chosen them to be his holy nation. If you keep my covenant and follow my annunciations, so this people with one voice raise their shouts to the skies of endless blue. Everything the Lord has spoken, we will do. This promise, offered like a bouquet to God from his chosen few, came from all Israel, meaning every single Jew was entering into a new covenant. But none of them could fathom what this promise meant. For they were promising to be steadfast, to abandon their past. And no matter what God asked, no matter the test or request, they had pledged to answer yes. Now this was so much more than mere obedience, more than sheer compliance. For this covenant ensured their entire reliance on God alone. For the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the great I Am, seated on heaven's throne, was building a home with insignificant Israel. So God posted some house rules to protect his own children, to set apart his holy brethren. And from this intention to hold the world and the kingdom in tension came the intended commandments of 10. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of slavery. So, 1, you shall have no other gods before me. 2, you shall not make any idol for worshiping. 3, you shall not take my name in vain or make it empty. 4, you shall remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. The 10's first 4, at their very core, say with no facade that our God is a jealous God, that there is no golden calf, no idol half as glorious as our Lord. For what more could we strive? Let the 10 begin again with 5. Honor your father and mother. 6, you shall not murder. 7, you shall not be an adulterer. We are meant to worship God as master and serve him only, but how are we to relate to one another in a way that is holy? 8, you shall not steal. 9, you shall not falsely with a neighbor deal. And 10, you shall not covet anything another wields. These final 3 aim to defeat deceit and greed from polluting our souls. For Satan prowls and patrols, looking for ways to circumvent our covenant's holdout on sin, to desecrate and condemn the precepts protected by the 10. So may this people cry out for all that is holy and true. Everything the Lord has spoken, we will do. For it's the same today for me and for you. Everything the Lord has spoken, we will do. We're still called to obey like those wandering Jews. Everything the Lord has spoken, we will do. For we are the royal priesthood. We are the chosen few. Everything the Lord has spoken, we will do. So let the 10 spoken then begin again for me and you, and say it with me if you choose. Everything the Lord has spoken, we his people will surely do.
Everything the Lord has spoken, we will do, because he is the Lord who delivers us from sin, because he is the God who freed his people from slavery, because he is the God who calls us out of darkness into his wonderful light, because he is the Lord who gave us a second chance, because he is the one who loved us enough to send his only son to this earth to die on our behalf, because he is the God who doesn't just want to live near us, who doesn't want to just dwell among us, but he wants to live in us by his Holy Spirit. So everything the Lord has spoken, why wouldn't we do? Let's bow our heads together. I'm going to ask those of you who are going to help with communion today, if you'd slip out. Quietly prepare. You know, the Bible says in Galatians 2 that if righteousness could be gained through the law, through the commandments, Christ died for nothing. But it can't. The law is that mirror, and it helps us see our need for Jesus. Jesus explained it this way. He said, "This cup of communion is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." It's the new agreement, the new covenant. Romans says there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Jesus Christ, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. What the law was powerless to do, God did by sending his own Son. Have you said yes to him? Have you invited him into your life? You might do that today around the communion table, and you might just say, "Jesus, today, I put you in the preeminent place in my life. No other gods before you." Trays will come by in a moment. Take the bread and the cup as it's passed, and then you just have some time to solitude. Do some business with God. If you're not comfortable participating in communion, that's fine too. No sweat on that. Just use these moments to allow God to speak to you, to reflect on what you've heard today. Father, it is our intent to say everything you have spoken we will do, but we know we fail. And that's why we're so thankful for this table that tells us there is amazing grace for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. A righteousness that can't be found by keeping rules, by keeping the law, by keeping the commandments, but can only come by your Son who sets us free from the law of sin and death. God, thank you for being a God who doesn't just desire to interact with us or be near us, but to live in us, to be with us, to come by your Holy Spirit into our lives and to give us gifts that you can use to advance your work in this world, to give us discernment, to help us understand the truth of your word. Thank you for your Spirit in us that gives us power to be witnesses for you in this world with what we couldn't do in our power of our own words. Thank you for the Spirit that convicts us of sin and areas in our life that need attention. Thank you for your Spirit that guides us, that comforts us when we're grieving. Oh God, thank you that you are with us and in us. In Jesus' name we pray.